could have kept going. I could have harassed him. I could have been sarcastic, you know, but trying to give him the benefit of the doubt. And it's almost like they didn't disappoint anybody. They continued to act the way they did. They have no, they didn't care that the world is watching. And I don't realize, I don't think they realize that the world is watching. The world is going to hold them accountable. So from that point on, we have the, they created a lot of pedestrians. Now, if you grab onto my car or something and I take off, I'm not responsible for killing you. So this is a law we're trying to pass. They're trying to cover their tracks along the way. We're going to continue to show this. We're going to continue to draft the legislation. We're reading it. We're reading any policies they're pulling through. And we want to encourage you guys to do the same. And when you guys do send your comments, that will be real short. Really short. But so many, I've still got about 1,400 I got to read. I'm reading up to like 5 or 6 hours a day trying to go through them all. And I started reading them because people were saying, my auntie's coming up, my grandma's coming up, can you check on my brother? That's how I started reading all these comments. It got really overwhelming. And so I had a good team now to help. And it's gotten bigger. And now we've got more and more people helping document, helping research, helping holding them accountable. And I want to thank you all because without you, I couldn't do this. And it's been a journey because I'm learning a lot on how to protect ourselves from what's continuing to destruct our Mother Earth, our sacred sites, our traditional medicines. And right over the hill in Nevada, well, there's a lot of water on this side, and our river, there's no water right now. Well, that is flooding in some areas. So we're seeing special interests divert that water. That's why I'm in Standing Rock, mining, and the corporate farmers going farther and farther to the aquifers and using an abundance of water and over exceeding their limit of water and knocking out just the grassroots farmers. So these are things we are witnessing, that the fight is going to be for natural resources. As you know, the new administration wants to privatize our lands. 70%, 60-70% of the natural resources is in Indian country. So this is the next battle, is water and those resources, mineral extractions. So just be aware, educate yourself. Like I tell many of our non-native relatives, the way you honor us is by learning about us. So we know everything about you. And it's okay to ask. Only dumb question is an unasked question. So you gotta ask, you gotta educate. We've got so many native universities that have Native American Studies departments in there. You can, by the internet, you can go and actually go to the tribe. You can ask these questions directly to them. And I apologize again in advance if you don't get that warm feeling, because a lot of our people don't have the healing that some of us do have. Articulate what that feeling means. I grew up in a place where I grew up in tribal prejudice in a different tribe, although at the time I didn't know I was of that tribe. That's the historical trauma part we've learned, and we're getting around that. Then when I came into the city, I wasn't accepted by the Indians in the city, so there was another one. So, you know, we've got to work together, and we've got to understand and identify that it was learned. So we're re-traditionalizing the way we think, decolonizing in a process. So what does that mean? It's reconnecting to your roots. And that we can be indigenous in the 21st century. For thousands of media that came through, I was able to get the digital protocol. Follow the protocol. When it went up and filmed their ceremony, filmed their children, asked for permission, why it's important after filming their ceremonies, with the footage. This is a visual legal narrative. Where do you bring your footage when you're done to help us? Many of our non-native relatives and our own people will bring that footage up, and it's what we're fighting today to protect our relatives that are in getting ready to go to court, getting ready to face those charges and felonies. We're stepping on this side of the line. No longer was it a misdemeanor, now a felony. People that were pulled out of sweat during that sweat were charged with inciting a riot and also fired, which are several felonies. So these are the things we documented. Documented from the air, documented from the ground, that live streams going. It's also the first time I think that I know was when there was a full media blackout. And I don't know if you guys were watching on that November 20th or October 27th when they took the North Camp, all of a sudden there was no more live feeds anywhere. That's the moment we went down and actually just started. have is in your hand, but also the tools that you have in your hand makes you vulnerable, because the communication part was such a beautiful time in the summer. They had several blockers there. We all had to talk to each other. So I kind of like to everybody know that it was an amazing time to be indigenous at that time, because this is how it was. I mean, this is a beautiful time that all of people experience and share and have somebody tell you to do that. It's a beautiful time. Welcome home, sister. Where are you from? Kind words like that. One of your tents, someone will come right over and help you. Ask you what you need. You need a sleeping bag, you need a cup, what you need. If you're an elder, then make sure you got wood. And it was a beautiful time to participate in and to re-indigenize the way and re-traditionalize what we're seeing around us. So I just want to share those small little things. I know we all have a different experience. But I sat, I got to sit many times and just watch before, the chaos hit, and watch people cuddle together and enjoy that moment in time with our indigenous relatives and regain what it was to be indigenous here for our people at that time. Wow, what a beautiful moment. And I'm wondering now is how do they handle the 93 degree weather? Well, they're huddling. They're in teams. Some are here still in reinforced tents, yurts. They're doing it. So if you guys have any questions, I'll open it up for questions. And let me start like this. Department of Lots.